What's the word, y'all? Welcome back to the Call Game Recap. Today, I watched a ton of basketball, and a lot of it, and I mean a lot of it, was ugly. But you know what? Sometimes I can enjoy the ugly games. We're at the part of the season where teams are playing back-to-backs very, very often. 3 games in 4 nights, 5 games in 7 nights. So yes, your favorite team is probably tired today, and they didn't have the legs to hit that three-pointer. But when you get two teams that are like on their last leg and the game is close, yes, it's ugly, but I like those games sometimes. And today had a ton of those games. Leave a like, subscribe if you are new. I think I want to open up today's show talking about these three teams that I believe are at a crossroads on what the heck do they do in this next week. As you know, the trade deadline is coming up, baby. It's the most important part of the season. We've already seen two relatively big trades. Teams that consider themselves contenders trying to stockpile. The Miami Heat got rid of Myers Leonard. And he got rid of Myers Leonard, got back Trevor Ariza, and then PJ Tucker got traded for the DJs, who were in the layup line for the Milwaukee Bucks. So those are two teams that are playing good basketball right now, that just upgraded their depth a little bit, which is really cool. These three teams that I'm thinking about on the top of my head have to figure out what they're going to do. Those teams are the Indiana Pacers, the Toronto Raptors, and the Boston Celtics. All three have been the beacon of consistency over the last couple seasons. Those are three teams that you might as well lock them into the playoffs the last couple years. Now, not really the case, which is really, really crazy. Let's start off with the Boston Celtics, because at this point in time, they have a 500 record. We are 40 games into the season. If you would have told me that we'd be 40 games to the season and the Boston Celtics would be 500, I would have called you crazy at the beginning of the season, especially without any of their all-star players been injured. Yeah, Kemba Walker's been in and out of the lineup. Marcus Smart missed significant time, but this is still super, super underwhelming. Now, my guy, J.E. Skeets, he's a host of the No Dunks podcast. He said this perfectly on his show today, and I cannot agree more. They have to figure out if they want to make those trades who can better now, which is, I mean, that's asking for much for Danny Ainge, because he's always super, super close to doing a trade but never really doing it. Do they want to do that, or do they want to take their foot off the gas? Now, if you don't remember, the Boston Celtics have made the Eastern Conference Finals 3 out of the last 4 years. They've always been able to make the playoffs and make a run. But at this team right here, I don't have any confidence at the way this team is built right now that they can make a large run. And when I say take their foot off the gas, I don't mean they go into tank mode. I don't mean sell the assets. But instead, you play Robert Williams way more than what you have been. You play Peyton Pritchard a lot more minutes in the game, and Kemba Walker didn't play today. Peyton Pritchard only played like 18 minutes. So it's either, yes, we're going all in to continue to be contenders, or we're like, let's build the core players that we have. Because we know Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum, they are who they are. They're still growing as players as well, but they're already all-stars. But they got some people in the pipeline. Robert Williams has been incredible recently, but he needs to get more minutes. So they have to figure that out, man. They have to figure that out. Today was just bad, bro. There's no fluidity in the offense. It's all isolation between the Jaylen Brown and Jason Tatum, and no off-ball movement. It's just absolutely bad. They lost to the Cleveland Cavaliers, and that is inexcusable if you ask me. Shout out to the Cavalier Sexland backcourt, because they played really, really well today. And then Isaac Okoro had a big game too, offensively and defensively. But the Boston Celtics have to figure it out. The second team we wanted to talk about is the Indiana Pacers. They lost to the Brooklyn Nets today without Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving. James Harden has been incredible. We will talk about him and Nicholas Claxton a little bit, but let's focus on the Indiana Pacers, because they are 5 games under .500 right now. That is mind-blowing. The Indiana Pacers has always been a team that's going to be the 4-5 seed every single year, and they're going to compete in that first-round series and maybe get out of it. Not this year. And I don't really know what the remedy of it is. When I watched this game, because I did watch this game, Malcolm Brogdon, and I think I've said this on the show before, definitely exceeds when the ball is not in his hands all the time. And right now, he is their point guard. It is him. It is TJ McConnell's the backup. He is their point guard. But his best years, as far as like efficiency goes, is when he's playing off guard with the Milwaukee Bucks. Right, Malcolm Brogdon's a very, very, very good NBA player, but times in this game where it was late in the fourth quarter, it was more isolation for Malcolm Brogdon. He's never been a guy that's going to sauce you up and get to the basket. He knows how to get to a spot. He can get to a spot and pull up. Those are the things he's good at. But as the guy on the Caris LeVert should be getting some of those looks, and I know we're only, 3 games into his coming back from this season, but they have to figure it out. Now, I don't know if this is a team that should be trading. This is not a team that should be going for the tank at all. I just don't know what it really is. And then after this game, it made me think about their draft history. And, well, they don't draft very well. And a lot of that is because they're at the end of the lottery, or right outside of the lottery. But they haven't hit any of those gems. Miles Turner's like their best draft other than Paul George in recent history. It feels like they've missed on a lot of those other guys. They got Goga Badazzi, who hasn't done anything in his NBA career just yet, but I'm not counting him out by any means. But just like that, it seemed like he was a reach of a pick then, and now he's not contributing on a team that's trying to do their thing. And now we go to the Toronto Raptors. First of all, Norman Powell, what a great performance by him. Him and Chris Boucher were the only two players that can hit a shot today, so that's why they lost. But they also have to figure out, y'all have heard the rumors about Kyle Lowry, and they have to figure out if they want to actually make this trade next week to continue to go to the next era of Fred VanVleet, Norman Powell, OG Anunoby, Pascal Siakam, and Chris Boucher. Because right now, Fred VanVleet, you're not going to win games if three, and Pascal Siakam, three of your top scorers just don't score the ball, 100%. But we can all agree this has also been a very underwhelming season for them. Norman Powell has been on fire, and I feel like they haven't been able to capitalize on it. He had 43 on 18 shots. 43 on 18 shots today, and they couldn't capitalize on that. Some of that is because he missed a free throw again today, just like he did against Atlanta. But regardless, they have to figure out what the next step of their franchise is, because I think if you trade Kyle Lowry, you're still an okay team, and you're still probably good enough to make the playoffs, and you could continue to focus on Fred VanVleet potentially being the future point guard of your team after you just paid him. You know what I'm saying? He had played point guard his entire career until just like 2 years ago, and that's probably his position. While we're talking about this game, Detroit, Sadiq Bey continues to play with this poise of a veteran. You know what I'm saying? I just love to see him be successful. My guy Mike has been a fan of him for a very long time, so Mike is keep hitting the group chat like, yeah, you see Sadiq? Yes, I've seen Sadiq. He's playing very, very well. And then a dagger from Jeremy Grant. This game don't mean a goddamn thing for the Detroit Pistons, but I bet it means something for Dwayne Casey, right? Dwayne Casey gets a win against his former team again. Josh Jackson hit some big-time shots. I'm convinced Isaiah Stewart is the center of the future for them. They played a solid game. And those are the three teams that have to figure out what the heck they're going to do in this next week. Let's go on to the other games or other teams. Let's go back and talk about James Harden, because he had another 40-point triple-double today. And if it wasn't for the whole Houston debacle of the way he got out and all of this, he would be in MVP conversations as he always is. And when he does stuff like this, of course, I'm impressed, because it's James Harden. It's fun to watch. But he's been doing this for his entire career. You know what I'm saying? Like, I feel like some people are like, man, have you seen James Harden? Yes, I've seen him. For years and years and years, he's always been top five in MVP voted, because he's just that nice. You don't need super good NBA players alongside James Harden. That is the biggest plus about having James Harden in your team. Kyrie can take a step back because he's managing an injury. Kevin Durant can sit out a couple weeks because we know James Harden can single-handedly get us a couple wins. And he did that his entire career in Houston, and now he's doing it again in Brooklyn. If it wasn't for the first month of the season of all the press conferences showing up late, yada, 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 100% the media will be all over James Harden back as one of the top three favorites to win MVP. Because, of course, he is performing like that. But you know they got to care about that first month. Do I care about that first month? No, not really. I don't. I think both teams walked away with what they wanted. The Houston Rockets got the draft picks, and the Brooklyn Nets got an unstoppable force, bro. Nicholas Claxton, while we're here, and then we'll move on to the next game. Nicholas Claxton was one of the guys. Now, when I went to the draft combine in Chicago a few years ago, I had never heard of him before. I'm not a college basketball watcher, even though March Madness starts tomorrow. I'm excited about that. I'm not a college basketball watcher other than March Madness, so I didn't know the name of Nicholas Claxton until I got to the draft combine, and they were doing those scrimmages, and he played harder than anybody else. He was switching onto these guards and playing great defense, and that's exactly what you got today. Late in this fourth quarter, he was switched on the guards, and it didn't even matter. He held his own, and those are the type of minutes you're going to need from him. He played 22 minutes. He played more minutes than DeAndre Jordan, because DeAndre Jordan can't defend the pick and roll like Nicholas Claxton can. At the end of the day, DeAndre Jordan is a little bit older. Back in the day, DeAndre Jordan did his thing on the pick and roll switch, but not anymore. Nicholas Claxton has that foot speed, and it's working really, really well. It's a very dangerous, dangerous team. I don't know how I'm 9 minutes into this, and I haven't talked about this game, but here we go. Milwaukee Bucks versus the Philadelphia 76ers. A great game. I mean, one of those ugly games that I mentioned earlier, but of course the end of this game is what made it great. Where you have the Milwaukee Bucks going this late fourth quarter run. I think it was like an 8-2 run, and you think it's put away. Jrue Holiday hits this corner three-pointer that rattles in, and you're like, okay, that's the win for Milwaukee. No, still got some fight for the 76ers. And again, I'm so impressed with the 76ers. They didn't win this game, but the fact that they are able to stick in this game where, A, Joel Embiid is not there. There's their other scorer, Tobias Harris, who had been carrying them offensively as far as scoring points over the past couple weeks. He didn't have a good game, and they were still in this one with a pretty much fully healthy Milwaukee Bucks is impressive to me. They went on that huge run with Furkan Korkmaz hit that corner three, and whoever was on the call said it perfectly. Dante DiVincenzo reaches for some reason, and Furkan Korkmaz hits this 1,000th consecutive corner three. He don't miss from that. He just don't. If he got an open corner three, you might as well count it. Then we get to the overtime. And this is where Giannis puts on the crown or whatever. I tweeted it. He has some nerve. He went on this nice run by himself, which is beautiful because the narrative around Giannis is that he can't close games. He's not a go-to guy when it matters the most. Today, he was that guy. He scored like 7 or 8 straight points, and then going into a timeout, he sat on the floor in the middle of the Philadelphia 76ers court. That is a ballsy play, Giannis, especially when there's still time on the clock and this game is not completely secured. If you would have blown that game, if they would have lost that game just like they let up that other run, memed. But he hit a big time 3-pointer after not hitting any for this game, played great defense. It's a very MVP type performance for Giannis. I'm enjoying this season mostly because there's no runaway for MVP. Joel Embiid was number one on my list, but with him being out for at least two weeks, it's up for the grabs. It could be Jokic, it could be Giannis, it could be James Harden, it could be LeBron. And there's so many different candidates. It could be Dame. There's so many different candidates, and I love it. I feel like a couple years, the last couple seasons, when we were a couple months into the season, we knew this is Giannis's award to lose. We don't have that right now. You know, we don't have that right now. So, you know, Milwaukee Bucks get a win. Was it impressive? It was fun. It was impressive to see Giannis take over in the overtime. But again, you are messing with a team that was missing their MVP candidate. And then their other leading scorer, Tobias Harris, shot 30% from the field. You know what I'm saying? Ben Simmons hit a 3-2. You know, that was fun. How about we just kind of shoot those in rhythm a little bit more, Benjamin? Is that his name? We're just going to say it's Benjamin. Next game, we had De'Aaron Fox calling game on the Washington Wizards. This is a game that nobody wanted to win. I feel like it was two tanking teams, and I don't know if the Sacramento Kings are actively tanking. I couldn't tell you. It felt like they were in this game. Nobody wanted it. Russell Westbrook had a fourth quarter that was impressive, but then it ended in a turnover where they run this sideline out-of-bounds play, and there's a miscommunication. He throws it out-of-bounds, yada, yada, yada. I didn't really care about this game, even though I watched it completely. Another game I didn't care about, I did care about, but it hurt my heart, was this Chicago Bulls game where they had the ugliest fourth quarter in recent history. Thank God this was not a nationally televised game, because you know what I was saying about the Pelicans yesterday, about them just folding? Folded like a lawn chair, the Chicago Bulls in the fourth quarter to a Spurs team without DeMar DeRozan, without LaMarcus Aldridge, and these should be wins. We're about to go to the toughest part of our schedule, and if we want to be a playoff team, we need to win games like this. We needed to win that game against the 76ers where Joel and Ben Simmons was gone. We needed to win that game against the Miami Heat, who were hot at the time, but were missing Bam Adebayo. We needed to win this game. Now we got games against like the Nuggets, the Utah Jazz. The second half of this schedule is really tough, and if we can't close out against the Spurs, who are missing DeMar DeRozan, then I don't know how we can look at ourselves and be like, we're potentially a playoff team. Next game is the Miami Heat versus the Grizzlies. Another very, very ugly game. It ended with Ja Morant hitting the game winner. Whatever. Shout out to Ja Morant. The Heat are one of those teams that are 5 games and 7 nights, so I don't look at this game and be like, oh, they fought. Nah, it was an ugly one. It was an ugly one. And the grit and grind, do we still call the Grizzlies grit and grind? I don't really know. They grinded this game out and got the victory. And then Luka put it away, put it on, all on the Clippers. The Clippers are missing something. Kawhi said it. Everybody knows that the Clippers are missing something. When you look at this team, you watch them play, it doesn't feel like there's a team that should be in the upper echelon of the NBA right now. I'll say it. They should be extreme buyers during this deadline. I don't know how. I don't know how you become extreme buyers. This man, Luke Kennard, got paid $18 million to get a DNP coach's decision. How? How? They need to be buyers. I don't know. They don't have many assets. They traded all their picks away to get Paul George. Nobody really wants Lou Williams right now, I don't think. They don't have assets, but they need something. That point guard position is really lackluster. Reggie Jackson played 20 minutes. He scored 5 points. Lou Williams was playing that backup point guard. He shot 2 for 10. They don't have that floor general facilitator. Paul George came in. He tried to keep them in this game, but it was Luka. 42? I didn't even realize he put up 42. I just knew he was hooping out there. 42, Luka Magic. And just like that, those are all the games that I watched today. I saw that Steph Curry hurt his bum, so I hope he's doing all right. Thank y'all so much for watching. Call game.